Thank you very much, Sid, and thanks to the Institute for having me. This is my first visit, enjoying it greatly. Thank you. Okay, so I'm going to talk about fluctuations and order, and I'll define things as I go along, but more than defining, I'd like to give you all a feel of what the question is. You can see something I've drawn here. Ah, okay, good. So let me use this. Right. What it's supposed to depict is the following. So in fact, let me do it in real, sort of real demonstration. So I have a handkerchief, okay? And just imagine that I'm shaking it around. When I shake it, there are small hills and valleys that form, small or big. And this, I'll continue doing this. Imagine that I've sprinkled a whole lot of, let's say, sugar, the old granular sugar, on it. And we're doing this. There's gravity. So things on a hill will try to fall into a valley, and they'll collect in valleys. But then, because I'm shaking, what's a valley now will become a hill later. So things that have gathered will fall out, so fall in, fall out. That's the dynamics of the sugar particles or granules, you might imagine. So what's happening? If you think of, okay, so that's what I've tried to depict here. Here's a fluctuating surface, the handkerchief. On top is some sprinkled stuff. Looks more like pepper here, but you know, imagine it's sugar. And question is, what happens at very large times if I keep shaking? Turns out the sugar, at least in the models, sort of comes together. Not necessarily in one very clean, large globule, but there are very large portions of the handkerchief which will be covered by sugar. And this bunch of stuff has its own dynamics. It stays a large bunch and it moves around. And it's this aspect that I'm going to try to capture and also characterize quantitatively and see if there are some nice signatures one can look for. We'll also talk about possible applications as we go ahead. Okay. So the randomly evolving environment in most of the talk that will stay here will be a fluctuating surface. And the things that are ordering or fluctuating are things that are sprinkled on it, particles. By the way, if there's anything I say not clear or motivation-wise or even statement-wise, just ask me. No, no, it's a closed system. In fact, we can imagine periodic boundary conditions, so nothing can escape but fluctuations. Right. So I have to say that this sort of study has been going on for a long time. In fact, close to 18 years or something like that. And many students and postdocs and visitors who have come to the Tata Institute and elsewhere, you know, have been involved with this. Last two at TIFR Hyderabad, others at TIFR Mumbai. Okay, so I thought I must put up this list because the work is really distributed and shared. Okay, let me begin by, you know, saying what we are talking about. Fluctuations and order. This is the sort of theme. And in fact, if you talk to statistical physicists, often these are the two things that they're concerned about. Fluctuations we're all familiar with. I mean, and fluctuations people think of in different ways. Now, like here you can see something with density fluctuations. And if you just imagine taking a walk across along the line here, you'd see the density going up and down in some erratic way. Further, if you were to take you know, different portions of this graph, I mean different cuts along the graph, blue or red, you can then use this data to build up a probability distribution. So you can think of fluctuations in various ways. I mean, that's fine. But I guess it's familiar enough to all of us. Order, what do we mean? You know, order is a it's something that you can look up in a dictionary, and the dictionary definition is a little complicated, but I've just put in a definition of my own. It's basically that we have an arrangement which extends to large distances. The large distances is important. I mean, if you have something that is ordered in a small region, it's ordered, it's okay. But the sort of order that I'll be interested in today is something that goes over large distances. Large compared to the, let's say, size of the handkerchief or whatever it is that is shaking it. Not always, but certainly the things I've shown here have a symmetry. And the things I've shown here, for instance, here there's a sublattice symmetry. So I would say this arrangement is ordered. Of course, it's not perfectly ordered because a red square has moved from here to there. But that doesn't matter. You don't. When we talk about order, we're not insisting on perfect order. We're imagining there's a template. There's a perfect template, whether ordered or not is a question. Let's say it's whether it has a symmetry or not is a question. Let's say it does. If there's a, and you superpose the configuration you have on that template, and if there's a substantial overlap with the template, okay, that's one way to characterize the order. Templates could be of various types. For instance, it could be alternating here, or it could be simply a bland, single, one-color template of this sort. It could be that the one-color template, you don't mind the color, whether it's red or green. It could be that in one region of the sample, you have one color. In the other, you have another color. That's pretty well ordered as well in my lexicon. Okay, so this is what I'd like to say. Now, the question we're going to ask and address, amongst other things, is can an ordered state survive in the presence of very large fluctuations? What do I mean by very large? I mean, if you have a quantity which has an average value, let's say the fluctuations of the order of that average value. If the object, if the quantity is scales with the volume, the fluctuations themselves are also proportional to the volume. In such a situation, one would, you know, first of all, imagine, you know, somebody told me out of the blue, I would say, no, you can't sustain order because you'll just wipe it out. Turns out that's not the case. You can have ordered states and these giant fluctuations, and they can coexist. And this is the story I'm going to tell you. So the objective then is to discuss a sort of ordered state in which order does coexist with the very large fluctuations. It arises, as I said, in this system that I'm going to discuss of particles on a fluctuating surface. It exists in these systems. These are not the only systems in which that happens. We'll come to that a little later. So the way in which I'll proceed is, first I'll tell you a little bit about particles on a fluctuating surface. See, what is the fluctuating surface doing? It's creating an environment for the particles. Okay, that's clear. But there are many particles. So they have a shared environment. When particles which otherwise don't interact with each other share an environment, there are indirect interactions that build up. A favorite way of physicists modeling interactions is through direct forces, whether they be, you know, van der Waals or Coulomb or something or the other. That's one way. But here's another way. You have many particles sharing the environment and somehow getting correlated. Let's say getting correlated. Let's not use the word interaction. And correlations can induce ordering. Okay, so right. So that's what I meant by this statement: clustering due to a shared environment. I'll also talk a little bit about the conventional theory of ordered states and how they are reached in time. In other words, if you have a disordered state and the system likes to go to an ordered one, what happens in time? how does it do it? That will then come to the key point of this talk, namely fluctuation-dominated order, you know. And there are two key characteristics. One is that the ordered region itself has immense fluctuations in as a function of time. And the other thing is that there are very broad interfaces between ordered regions. We'll quantify this later. Finally, I'll end off by talking about other systems which also show fluctuation-dominated order. These are models of proteins on cell membranes, and completely differently, what's become quite exciting nowadays, active matter. So particular models of active matter, namely self-propelled rods which could be viruses, for instance, which are propelling themselves in some crowded environment, also seem to show this behavior. Okay, I should say that particles in fluctuating fields as a whole is not a new topic at all. It has been discussed for years in the context of turbulence. And here's a good review of many years of work in turbulence. And in turbulence, of course, the experiment is that you have a turbulent fluid and you release a little bit of dye on the side and you ask for what happens to the dye as time passes. Why is it a non-trivial problem? You know, you might imagine the dye to be carried along by streamlines, which themselves, of course, tortuous. That's true, but that's not the end of the story, because particles can diffuse. They can jump from one streamline to another. And therefore, the arrangement of the particles tells you is a little more intricate than just sketching the streamlines of the flow. So that's been studied for many years and obvious practical importance, you know, spread of pollutants, this, that, whatnot. There's a beautiful paper long ago, 1985, by Deutsch, which talks about how tracks coalesce when things are subjected to correlated noise. And in a general sense, belongs to this class of problems we're discussing. Yeah, tracks that are, so if you have particles which are dispersed, if they cluster, the tracks coalesce. You know, so but somehow in that literature, this is the word that's used, path coalescence. So there's a lot of work on that, but that's what it means, gathering up. And as I said, proteins on actin stirred cell membranes, and a couple of very interesting articles on this aspect. I'll talk about this earlier paper a little bit towards the end of the talk. Okay, so here we are. Let's begin by this model of the fluctuating handkerchief. And I've already said what's on this slide. We imagine the particles are light. Where does the lightness come in? It comes into the fact that they don't influence the handkerchief. If I imagine putting ball bearings on this, they would push down the handkerchief and make upward fluctuations harder. I'm ignoring that, or I'm saying that that's not there. The particles are light enough that they're influenced by the fluctuations, but they don't back act. Again, at the very end, if there's time, and if there's interest, I mean, and if there's a question, okay. I'll tell you what happens if there is back action, but yeah, is it fluctuating?
Fluctuating
surface. What should I do? Okay. Okay, very good. So just to give you an idea of what can happen, is it possible to turn off the lights for a minute? Yeah. Okay. I think that.
If you could drop that shade.
Yeah, only for this slide. We can have it back later. So here I've tried to show you as a function of space and time. If the surface is replaced by a single line which is fluctuating and you have particles which are spread over, and this is telling you about the particle density. So there are as many particles as sites on a lattice, 256 of them, and the line is being shaken in different ways. I'm not telling you exactly the rules for shaking, But there are three pictures here, and the three correspond to three different things that can happen to the line. The first thing is that, okay, let's think in terms of the handkerchiefs. The handkerchief is fluctuating, but as it's fluctuating, I might keep moving it downward. That makes it a little easier for things to gather in the valleys. Or I could have a very unbiased sort of no downward or upward motion, just fluctuations, which is the central, okay, thanks, but, okay, let me continue. Okay.
Because I don't, I mean, my screen turns, does, well, okay.
Is that yours, Sid?
This is mine, yeah. Do I system preferences and play around? Oh, now it's back again, so.
Yeah, if you go to the preferences, it'll get busy. I mean, it might be that, it often is. Just, and it's like energy savings, you know.
Yeah.
Display sleep, just put that to never or something.
Okay. All right.
See if that works.
Okay. Okay, very good. We're back. And the last picture shows you what would, I mean, it corresponds to a hanky in which particles are falling down, but the surface is moving up. So there are three different cases. And you can see the patterns of collection are very different in the three. Things collect very efficiently almost in one tight cluster here. This is the case with particles with no interactions at all. So you can have massive pileups in a place, okay? And what you see is in a time of order, something like that, things have gathered up into essentially one fairly localized region. Okay, but you remember the pictures, yeah.
So if I scroll through, then it seems.
Okay. All right.
Do you want to
next
one?
No, not yet. Yeah. So I just wanted to emphasize that the amount of clustering depends on the dynamics of shaking. Not surprising, but I just wanted to make the point that it does. Even when this sort of coalesces into one localized region, it doesn't always stay that way. Notice that it splits up later, but rejoins again. And much of the time, it's together. I mean, okay. So, yeah, let's scroll down. Okay. Today, I'm going to discuss what happens if, in addition to this, we also have hardcore interactions between particles. So they cannot pile up into extremely compact clusters. I mean, they can get close to each other, but the hardcore interaction prevents total collapse, let's say. What happens in that case? Well, in that case, basically what happens is that the clusters, which were very compact earlier, spread out. Okay, and this is the nature of the phase of the state that results. Red and blue depict particle-rich and particle-poor regions. And you can see that there are basically two types of regions. One in which there's basically one color, space and time. So it's staying, either particle-rich or particle-poor. But in between, fairly broad,
HDMI.
distracting. I think.
Sorry about this.
Okay.
Of course, you walked in the room.
No, but Scott, it keeps fluctuating in and out without any tactile intervention.
Right.
Do you have another one? You should just go on.
Yeah, I'll just go on. So you can see a sort of rather mixed up region in between, and we'll have a little bit to say about that as we go ahead. Okay. So I've tried to describe in very qualitative terms what happens. Let me try to now see whether we can say something a little more precise about the nature of the state that is coming in. But before I do that, let me step back and remind you about how one discusses order, which extends to large distances, in statistical physics. So I'll try to do that here. So as I said, we'll say something is ordered or not if we look at a large distance and we see whatever pattern it is that we are talking about extending to large distances. Let's think about a system in which we have an equal number of, So let's imagine we have a lattice, with a certain number of sites. And let's say half the sites are occupied by particles. So this is the sort of scenario that I have. Now, of course, there are many arrangements possible, and the majority of them, in fact, will result in quite random disordered states. Some of them will result in things that are fairly compact, and those compact altogether states with some amount of fluctuations will designate as ordered. How do we quantify that? One way to do it in a system of this sort is to just look at the profile of the density. Remember, greens are particles, reds are empty sites. If you just look at the profile of the density and look at its Fourier transform with a very long wavelength Fourier mode of this sort, then the fact that this side is different from that will be pulled out. Whereas had you a configuration which is disordered of that sort, you won't get a signal at all. So is this fairly clear? I think it is. Let me go ahead. So the longest wavelength Fourier mode, a non-zero value of that will, in fact, pull out the fact of order. There's a completely different way of looking at the ordered, whether or not we have order in the system, and that is to look at a correlation function, which is related to the joint probability that two sites at site 0 and site R are occupied. And if I subtract off the mean density squared from this and ask how this function behaves, in a system which is disordered, this function falls to 0. But in the case where I in fact have what I'll call long range order, the function decreases but reaches a constant value. The order of limits is very important here. So we're thinking of a very, very large sample and then asking for the limit of separation of two sites after this system size has gone to infinity. Okay, so this will become clear in a minute why the order of limits is important. But so this is the other way to define order, and in fact the two go hand in hand. A non-zero value here would imply a non-zero value here, and so on. Okay, so this limiting value of this correlation function when r is very, very far away, I'll call g sub infinity, and whether or not it's zero or non-zero will tell me whether I have an ordered state or disordered state. Am I, are people with me so far? Yeah, okay, good, right. Next question we ask is, how does order develop in time? We now know what we're going to look for. We look, let's say, at correlation functions. But suppose we were to start with a completely disordered state. Imagine a magnetic system, okay, which is going to order below a certain temperature, but we take it to a very high temperature so that it's completely disordered. It's disordered. Now we suddenly move it to an environment, we put it in a bucket of ice, so it's cold, so it will order. But how will the order set in time? This is the question. And the answer is that bits of the phase of majority down and majority up spins will form. And as time passes, these bits will grow in time. There'll be fewer clusters, but they'll be larger. And they'll keep getting larger indefinitely in an infinite system. This process is called, I mean, there's a slightly jargonish word for it, coarsening. Because things are getting a little coarse. The description, a coarse description will do. Okay. But the implication is very direct and very strong. It is that this function g of rt, which we defined earlier, okay, now it's a function of time also, because this state here is very different from the state here, is different from the state there. So we want to characterize the state at a given time. So we look at this n density-density correlation function. And what we find is that it falls quite rapidly at a small time, less rapidly at a larger time, and very slowly at longer times. As when I say slowly, I mean as a function of distance. But amazingly, if you were to scale r by something that you can think of as the mean droplet size, or something to do with the size of the droplets, all these curves fall onto a single curve. There's a beautiful collapse, scaling at work. And the way in which L of t grows with time is, you know, is something that is well studied and well understood. But, okay, this is what happens in a regular ordered system. However, once we come to this other sort of order that I'm talking about, induced by the environment, we're going to see certain similarities and also certain differences. So let's see what they are. Okay, I think we can skip this. This is just to say that we're now turning to these fluctuation-dominated systems, but let's see what happens over there. Okay, just to define the model a little better, there's a very well-known and well-studied and well-understood description of fluctuating surfaces. This goes under the name of the Carr-Parisi-Zhang theory. We don't have to know too much about the theory for the talk today, but I'll just point out that the Carr-Parisi-Zhang theory talks about a height field for the surface. So if you imagine this as x and this is a height field h, then the height field itself evolves in time, and there are essentially three terms which govern the evolution. There is a term which tries to smoothen the height, coming, let's say, in some physical context from surface tension. I mean, if this is an interface. There's a term which is a nonlinear term, and this is a very crucial term. It comes in if you are distinguishing if the handkerchief is either moving up or down. If it's just fluctuating, there's no way to distinguish h from minus h. In which case, this term can't be there, because this is an equation which is invariant under h to minus h, except for this term. And then there's noise. Okay, right. Never mind. Just think about the particles. There are many of them, but for any one of them, which is at location x sub m, m being the particle itself, if you ask how does it move, we imagine that it is moving along the gradient of the height. Does that make sense? I mean, if you have a downward slope, the particle will slide down. That's all we're saying. That's all that term represents. No inertia, we're just talking about sliding. So no acceleration. Okay, so this is heavily damped. In addition, there are exclusion effects between particles. Okay, so this is the nature of the system. And the actual model that's simulated is actually very simple to describe. Let me do it here through these pictures. So you have a lattice again, but the lattice itself can fluctuate. So each bond of the lattice can either point upward or downward. Okay, and for instance, here's a particular configuration of the lattice. So how do the lattice fluctuations occur? If there are two unequal bonds, like here, this and that, a small hill, that can become a small, they can interchange, the bonds can interchange, and this hill can become a valley. Okay? You might say a valley can become a hill also. Certainly that's the case here, and this is the case where the fluctuations are sort of unbiased. Hill can become a valley, valley can become hill. But if you wanted to depict the handkerchief which is falling downward, then you just don't allow the upward move. So what happens? You get a tiny movement here and another, but overall it adds up to something fluctuating and moving down. And the other one, of course, just fluctuates on the right. But on top of that, there are particles. Particles don't do anything to the surface, but they try to fall down always. That's all. That's the dynamics. So here, this particle tries to fall down. This is on top of a hill, so it can fall equally likely to the right or the left. Okay, so there's a way to implement this dynamics, and you do it. Only thing is you respect the hardcore exclusion. So if this guy tried to hop down, he would not be able to do it. So that's why I put this line across this hop. Because there's already a particle there, something else can't occupy. So is the dynamics clear? Yeah. Yeah. You mean between this and that?
Yes.
The moves are different because here I'm not allowing upward motion.
Okay, the
cross means not allowed. Cross means not allowed. Of course, the other question you could have asked, as I thought you were asking that, is whether the rates of motion of the surface fluctuations and particle movement are the same or not. What I'll talk about today, we'll actually take them to be equal, but we've explored by changing them by factor 10 in either direction, and the essential conclusion I'll come to does not change at large enough R and time. Okay. Right, so is this clear so far? Basically, this thing is moving and these things are trying to go, you know, where they can. But then they fall out also. Right. So what happens? This is what happens. Okay. Here I'm just repeating something I've said earlier. So you form these small collections, but as time goes by, I'm claiming that things actually get together. And this is what happens. Typical size of a cluster, which is this script L of t, grows in time. Okay, now if this is going to happen, you know, okay, let us invoke the theory that I talked about. Correlation function is a function of R, but also a function of time. So as time goes higher, more correlations. But then if we scale the correlations by this growing length, we should get a single curve. You do. So these are the actual Monte Carlo results for correlation functions as a function of distance at short times and ever longer times, but scale by this growing length scale, everything falls onto one single curve. So now you say, fine, good. So it's all over. It's exactly as it was. It is, except for one change, which is turns out to be very significant, which we noticed and we didn't understand to start with, but now we do. And that is, look at this function. It has collapsed. Very good. But suppose I ask, what is the slope with which it hits the origin? Well, it turns out there's no, it gets ever sharper. It's a cusp. It's not falling linearly. In regular, ordinary phase ordering, this function falls linearly. The fact that it falls linearly goes under the name of the Porod law. The Porod law is a simple law to derive, and it's a little hard to see what could go wrong with it, but something is going wrong with it, clearly, because this is actually a cusp. So the next point in the agenda will be to understand what is the Porod law, why does it predict linear, and why does it break down here? So is the route clear? That's more important than anything else. So that's what I've said. There's a cusp singularity, this cusp, in the scaled correlation function. The singularity implies that the Porod law fails to hold. It's a statement, I mean, just that. And the interfaces are very broad and diffuse. And let me say that this violation of the Porod law is quite strong. You know, Porod law would say that this y should be 1. I'm sorry, not y, the exponent alpha should be 1. The values we find, depending on whether it's fluctuating or fluctuating, moving down, are quite different from 1, the half and a quarter. There are error bars on these numbers, but they're definitely not 1. So this is a strong violation of the Porod law. Okay, so now let me, this is the only sort of slightly longish transparency. Let me spend, okay, how am I doing? What time did we start? 1:15, okay. So let me spend about 3 minutes on this. Yeah. Okay. All right, so this I've already told you. And, you know, there's nothing new here. I've just repeated the fact that this scaling function is a scaling function of R. This is the case in which the Porod law is valid. This is the case in which the Porod law breaks down. The difference is in the curves. Linear, not linear. Yes.
The breaking of the law, right, it is even before you scale them all to be just one function. Each and every one of them has a cusp. Is this true?
That is true. However, there's a slight subtlety here, and that comes immediately to the point. If you don't scale, then what happens at very close distances may not reflect what the scaling function does. Because remember what this R and L of T are. In principle, you have to take a limit. R going to infinity, T going to infinity, keeping the ratio R over L fixed. So if you have R fixed and time very large, that will collapse to zero. Okay, so that cusp may not be captured by the point at zero or the point at one, but beyond, let's say, 3 or 4, yes. But this is the very related to the following fact. See, this is slightly counterintuitive, and let me just point it out simply because it is counterintuitive. The intercept of this curve tells you about long range order. Long range order was the limit R going to infinity. Here R by L is going to zero. Nevertheless, what I said is correct. This intercept tells you about long range order. Why? Imagine an infinite system. Okay. Now you fix yourself at some R and ask whether these things are correlated or not. Since you're interested in long range order, you put these 2 points very far apart. Okay, let's fix them here. But now having fixed them, we let time pass. R is fixed at a large value, but time goes to infinity, L of T goes to infinity. So no matter what R you start with, R by L will go to zero. Okay, so long range order is actually sensed by the intercept. And this is actually the way people sometimes find the long range order. But it is a little shocking when you first encounter it. So something going to zero, R going to zero. It's not R, the point is it's not R going to zero, it's R by L going to zero, where both R and L are infinite. Okay. Now, okay, this is the point that the intercept measures long range order. Observation is the scaling exponent is either less than or equal to 1 in different cases. Now, Poor law. The scaling function falls linearly, exponent alpha is 1. Now, I will give you a 1 minute argument as to why it has to be the case. Imagine there are two phases, brown and green. Okay. Actually, I tried to color this green, it didn't show up. Okay. I mean, fine. Anyway, it doesn't matter. You can see this is different from that. Now, how do we measure a correlation function? What you do, the best way is to take your fingers. Take two fingers. Put them there, here. Distance r apart. Now, both are in the brown region, so I get a positive. This times that is positive. I mean, now I move, 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 move. When I cross this interface, I get a negative signal, and then again positive on the other side. Is that intuitive? But now, how long did I get negative? That depends on how far my fingers were apart. If they're apart very little, I'll get very little negative. If I more, then I'll get more negative. Right? So, the deficit from perfect is proportional to how far my fingers are apart, proportional to r. Deficit is what we are measuring there, and that falls linearly. All this argument is relying on is that there are phases and there's an interface and you're straddling it sometimes. It's a very simple and correct argument in the sense that in many, many systems this works. Poirot himself was an X-ray crystallographer, and the implication of this in Fourier space is there's a large Q behavior of the scattering which falls as 1 over Q to the D plus 1. That plus 1 was the Poirot point coming from this linear. Now we are claiming this is not true. Why are we claiming that? Well, because we have evidence for that from the simulations. But then what does it mean? So the exponent is less than 1, and what it means that is that the interface is very broad. Let me elaborate on that in the very next slide, and then we'll stop talking about this cusp. So the key signature is that this alpha is different from 1. And it points to extremely broad interfaces between phases. Why? Because if my interface has a finite width, then for large r, I will always be able to straddle it. The width of the interface would be irrelevant. The only way in which I can have a violation of this is if the interface itself is infinitely large. So what is the picture? You have a phase, particle rich. You have a phase, particle poor. In between, you know, normally you have a sharp interface. Here the interface is very broad, zero surface tension. And this is actually what happens. Let me skip this argument. There's a nice way to relate this cusp singularity to the properties of random walks, but time is marching on, so I will skip this. You know, I can tell anybody later. Also make the point that this cusp is not an artifact of the one-dimensional geometry. We've looked at higher dimensions as well, like for instance, 2 dimensions. And here is, again, strong evidence of a cusp in the 2-dimensional falling handkerchief problem. The only other point of some importance on this slide is this line. If you have an infinite system, no problem, L of t will keep growing. But if the system is very large but finite, L of t cannot cross the size of the system, at which case it saturates. So what happens is that wherever you have scaling functions of r by L of t, in the steady state, which is reached when L of t becomes of the order of size L, that L of t can be replaced by system size. So what we are saying is that if you have a very large system of size L1 in steady state, you have a very large system of size L2 in steady state, there will be scaling which depends very strongly on the system size, not as a finite size correction, but as a finite size happening. You know, okay. The other aspect which goes hand in hand with this is that there are giant fluctuations of the order parameter. You remember the order parameter I wanted was this Fourier mode. And here is what happens to the Fourier mode when you plot it as a function of time. Turns out you can do a small calculation and convince yourself the largest the value of the Fourier mode is 1 over pi. And in fact, as it fluctuates, quite often that value is reached, which is very well ordered. But what is a little disconcerting is that, you know, quite often this plunges down to zero. And we were really very depressed to see this. It somehow seemed to us to mean that the order is lost. Actually, it isn't. And that took some time to realize. Let me just tell you what the resolution is. The resolution is the following. Okay, again, let us perhaps ignore all this. I mean, this is, again, looking at details of this. But look rather at this plot. Okay, you see some different colors, red, blue, red, purple, green, etc., right? Red is the signal which corresponds to the strong fluctuations that I have here. It's just that I've stretched the scale out. Okay, so what is happening is the following. You have this longest Fourier mode. It's very long, right? Yeah, I wish I had time to talk about this, but let me not. Fine. So here's the longest Fourier mode. But you see it becomes very low at some points. But at those points, the next Fourier mode, which is still very long wavelength but has a little more oscillations, that picks up. Look at this. When this comes down, these green and purple become large. So that is what is happening. The weight is going from one Fourier mode to the other and coming back. What does it mean? It's actually very simple to understand. Basically, this will capture the order where you have one large cluster here and one, you know, large cluster of the other sort there. But who knows, the clusters may break into two. Sometimes they will. It might become of this sort. In which case, this signal will not get any amplitude. It will get zero. But then you need the next mode to capture it. So this is what is happening. You have this giant cluster of sugar granules. It is moving around. It is doing things. It's fluctuating. Sometimes it's breaking into two. So here's a depiction space. This is compact. When you reach a time like this, there are two clusters. They rejoin. Is this system ordered? Yes, of course, because there is gathering on a macroscopic scale, on a very large scale. So the order is being passed around from, you know, tennis match from one Fourier mode to the other and coming back, mainly staying here and then going there. So that is what is happening. So let me see if I have a... Yeah, so very pictorially or let's say very schematically, that's the word I want. You know, think of all possible configurations. Most of them are disordered. Some of them are very well ordered, like this red kernel here. And like this, for instance, all reds here, all greens here. And this black thing is what your system is doing in time. Okay, so this is the trajectory of the system in time. And what I'm trying to depict is that the system spends a large amount of time with m equal to 1, sometimes goes to m equal to 2, very occasionally to m equal to 3, m being the number of chunks, but never to m equal to infinity. So it stays away from disordered states, but circulates in this attractor of ordered states. So this is the nature of the ordering. The fluctuations are immense. They are as big as the average, or bigger. But they are fluctuations which don't destroy the order. the fluctuations of the ordered region, and that is the key difference. Let me try to end then by talking about two examples where in fact this sort of state seems to show up. Okay, so this is a paper by Das, Pauli and Madan Rao, who were workers at NCBS, and they are talking about the following sort of system. So imagine you have a cell. There's a membrane, which is pretty fluidish, but below the membrane is a actin cycloskeleton, which gives this cell its shape. Please correct me if I say something wrong. Cyto. What did I say? Cyclo. Okay, cyto. Thank you. Right. Yeah, please feel free to correct. Okay. Right. So the actin itself, so imagine it like this. You have this actin, you have the fluid, and on the or in the membrane are floating about large molecules, proteins, etc., which either are sensitive to the actin filaments or not. Actin filaments have a polarity. So if something sits on that, it's sort of guided by the polarity and moves down there. Okay, this is supposed to be all well known in cell biology. And so here is a depiction. Now, the other thing that happens in the actin cytoskeleton is that the actin often arranges itself in asters, meaning these flower-like arrangements where things point inward. And if particles which are sensitive to actin, which are floating on the surface, attach to that, they will be drawn into the center of these pools. So this is the model proposed by Madan Rao and company to in connection with the experiments of Neil Goff and others on organization of proteins on the cell membrane. These asters, places where these gather, have a finite lifetime. They go away after a while. Well, very much like valleys where things are drawn in, but which eventually disappear. Okay, be that as it may, so what they've done is not a hill valley representation, which would be too naive, but model this with biologically relevant couplings and parameters. And what they observe is a very clean, so what they measured is a 2-point correlation function, and found an extremely clean cusp again. The value of the cusp exponent actually varies depending on parameter values, but roughly between 0.3 and 0.6 away from 1. In their phase diagram, which looks at the number of aster fractions and on one axis and time scales on the other, there's a large region which shows this cusp and fluctuation dominated phase ordering. There's also interesting things related to intermittency, but I won't comment on that because there's just 5 minutes to go. Turning to active systems. Active systems, as far as physicist goes, are systems in which there is a self-movement of the object in question. So pardon the jargon word active pneumatic. Forget about the word. Just imagine that you have rods with no head or tail, and a whole lot of them and fairly crowded, in which the dynamics, in addition to temperature and flow, etc., also has the propensity of each rod to move, either forward or backward, equally likely forward or backward, but more likely to move this way than that. Okay, so these are called self-propelled rods, and active matter is a, you know, rather well-investigated topic nowadays. There's a well-known model due to Chate et al., which is way back. That model was analyzed by these authors in 2012. Here are the density fluctuations that they observed. This is a blow up of one region, but you can see certainly inhomogeneities. You also see more than just plain old inhomogeneities. These are swirls, but the correlation function they measure in fact shows all the hallmarks of fluctuation dominated phase order, including the cusp exponent. So I just wanted to point out that, yes. The field meaning?
Yes, like the effective force field that they feel is not like an external.
No, not indeed not. No, it's much more complicated. Yes, and they can even back act on the.
Yeah, they can back act.
They can back act. Yes, so it's not that I'm saying that the Hill Valley model applies here. It does not, but the fact that there is, you know, there is a state. It's a new. It's a sort of state, with cuspy correlations with giant fluctuations. And okay, it seems to pop up in these different systems. Yeah, that is what I wish to convey. Okay, I won't talk as much about these other systems, but let me briefly say something. There's a careful experiment done on vibrated rods by Narayanan Menon, Vijay Narayan, and Sri Rama Ramaswamy. Again, from their data. These authors that we talked about in the last transparency re-examined the data and found that it is consistent with a cusp. It's not that there has to be a cusp for sure, but the way they analyze it makes it consistent. Completely different system, granular gases. Are you all aware of these systems at all? You all know what a gas is. Gas molecules rush around, they interact, they bounce and all. Granular gas is not molecules but marbles. They hit each other. What's the difference? Well, marble has a lot of internal degrees of freedom. So, energy need not be conserved. Collisions are inelastic. Unless you keep supplying energy, the system will just collapse. It will not keep, you know, it will not remain moving. Anyway, so there is a lot of study of such materials, I mean such systems for various reasons. And there's a careful study by these authors, which again shows a very strong cusp in density-density correlations. You know, whenever there's a cusp, I get excited. So I just put this down. Yeah. There's a very interesting bit of physics that has to go into this model, and this goes back to the work of C.V. Raman. Raman, you may have heard the name in connection with Raman effect, That's, of course, you know, Raman's primary contribution. But he pointed out that when two things collide, you know, it's not good to think that there's a coefficient of restitution and be done with it. Because imagine that the velocity of approach is very, very small. You know, in fact, coming to zero. Then there is practically no restitution. So the point is this coefficient of restitution depends on velocity of approach. And this feature was put into this model. The last thing I wanted to say is that recently, along with David Mukamel and Satya Mujumdar, we've been examining a model with long-range interactions. It's an equilibriumizing model in one dimension. It's actually a model which has been studied earlier, but we are now able to evaluate this correlation function exactly in this model. And sure enough, it has a cusp. So we're quite excited by this because it's a first principles calculation with no other approximation. So I think I end off now. And here are my conclusions. So, you know, fluctuations in order, very fundamental attributes of any system, any large system. And we've seen that these can coexist with order fluctuations. And the key signatures that I've tried to emphasize today are singularities in the two-point correlation functions, and that you need more than one Fourier mode. So you have a set of Fourier modes, and you need to examine the transfer of weight, you know, to what happens in one Fourier mode to the other, if you want a good description of the order. In fact, what you really need is joint probabilities, which are very difficult to handle, and we have not attempted that, but that is the way to do it. Okay, thank you.
In the active state membrane case, what do you mean by order state there?
By order, okay, so let me go back to the picture is right here. Okay, it turns out the way the Madan Rao model works is the following. There are two types of particles in the cell membrane, those that are sensitive to actin and those that are not. The ones that are sensitive to actin are showed in blue. The ones that are not are red. Okay, so reds are just background, if you like. These esters, these regions, form with a finite lifetime. Suppose something is born here. It's quite big. It will take time for things to cluster in there. And in fact, overlapping cluster esters are also possible. So the order we are talking about is the order of the blue particles as they tend to cluster within esters or collection of esters. They form drops, or they form chunks. And that is what we are trying to know. Yes.
If I recall correctly, you had mentioned that that is concomitant with
a broad. Yeah.
Being, very rough or the between the two phases.
Yes. Being very large, let's say. Yes.
Is that a general feature, or is that?
That is a general feature of fluctuation-dominated order, yes.
So the existence of a cusp
implies this.
Implies very generally that,
yes, yes.
That the two regions have a very rough boundary.
No, that's not enough that they have a rough boundary. That is one way perhaps it could happen. The other way is that, you know, in one dimension, for instance, the regions don't have a rough boundary. They just have a point. But it's not so much that as the space between ordered regions. Okay. If we have time, can I take 2 minutes to explain the random walk example or not? Maybe not. We will do it over. But the key point is that there should be, it's the size of the intervening interface, which is the crucial thing. It should be macroscopic. I should point out, actually, the work of Sanjay Puri and others in JNU and Varsha, I've forgotten his surname, Varsha Banerjee and others, has shown also that cusps arise in models with quench disorder, in random fieldizing models. And I think for similar systems, there must be domains which are separated by very ill-defined broad regions. But, okay, I don't know.
Any other questions? Well, if not, let's thank you, Mustansir, again.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm clapping for myself. What am I doing?
Right. We were a good audience. Yes.
Thank you.
Okay.
You know, there's a song from the Beatles, you know, Sergeant Pepper. No. I'm going to quote one line from there. You're such a lovely audience, I'd like to take you home. Right? So come to Hyderabad.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So
I guess your next stop is David.
Yeah, I forgot about that. Yes.
Yeah.
So you have to tell me whether I passed the test of conveying anything.
Oh, no, you certainly passed that test.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, in fact, it was remarkably clear. I mean, most of it.
It's a bit thanks to Sid. He kept saying that avoid jargon in your abstract, avoid this. So I went through three rounds and I worked quite hard on this to make the pictures and this and that. Yeah, good, but I'm glad it worked.
Yes.
So I unfortunately couldn't make it this morning. I just had to. There was a deadline in that I had to meet at home.
Right.
I slept at 7:30.
Okay.
So didn't see your message to just.
But can you come to dinner tonight?
I think that's very possible, likely. Our daughter is leaving in the evening around 5:45.
Okay.
But we'll drop her at the airport, and then we should be able to make it.
Okay, because it's right downtown.
Okay.
At 6 o'clock. I mean, I could change it to 6:15 if that would make it easier for you.
No, I think it should work.
Okay.
Six.
Okay.
It should work.
Excellent.
Great.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh,
all right.
Good.
Thanks.
Thanks
very
much.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Sanjay, is there time to meet sometime anyway?
Absolutely. I'll figure out something because right now he's sort of scheduled for most of the